What sort of religious upbringing did your father give you?
Oh, we were Swiss Reformed.
And did he make you attend church regularly?
Oh, well, that was quite natural. Yes. Everybody went to church on Sunday.
And did you believe in God?
Oh, yes.
Do you now believe in God?
Now? Difficult to answer. I know. I don't need to believe. I know.
Well, now, turning to the next staging point in your life, what made you decide to become a doctor?
In The God Delusion, Richard Dawkins plots a 7-point scale for belief in God, with a 7 being a committed atheist and 1 a devout theist. He places himself between 6 and 7, a de facto atheist, but not so committed as to appear foolish in his certainty. He uses Jung as an example of a number 1, quoting the line,
"I don't need to believe, I know."
According to Dawkins, it is in the nature of faith that one is capable, like Jung, of holding a belief without adequate reason to do so. What Dawkins doesn't understand is that the adequate reason for Jung's belief comes from a completely different meaning of knowledge, one that is essentially incompatible with his own. But what is truly ironic is that Dawkins doesn't recognize his own favorite meme when it's staring him in the face. Maybe he's forgotten what he wrote about God in The Selfish Gene nearly 50 years ago. Consider the idea of God. We do not know how it arose in the meme pool. Probably it originated many times by independent mutation. The survival value of the God meme in the meme pool results from its great psychological appeal. God exists, if only in the form of a meme, with high survival value. I mean, he literally states that God exists as a meme, which is true, but also a highly credible theological statement. Too bad that it's padded with nonsense. Saying that the survival value of the God meme results from its great psychological appeal is like saying that the survival of a gene results from higher fitness. It doesn't tell us anything. And it disguises the fact that Dawkins is avoiding the real questions. How did this psychological appeal arise? And why has it continued? Between the time of Jesus and the early 4th century, being a Christian was a criminal offense under the Roman Empire. But as the Christian Revolution spread, it also became increasingly organized. One of the leading figures in this regard was Irenaeus, an early Christian bishop who defended his faith against Rome.
Bishops were empowered to investigate and denounce heresy wherever they found
it. Early.
One of the most renowned heresy hunters was Irenaeus, Bishop of Lyon.
You are the Bishop of Lyon.
I am.
My privilege to greet you. I am Narcissus, honored pupil of Valentinus.
I am Irenaeus, pupil of Jesus Christ and of Polycarp, his servant, his witness.
In this clip, Irenaeus confronts Narcissus, a follower of the Christian Valentinus. According to Valentinus, salvation came not through obedience to the bishop, but through a form of individual enlightenment called gnosis.
I wish to comprehend, to understand, why you are indifferent to the commands of your bishop and of the apostles.
We revere, we love the apostles, in particular Paul, blessed Paul, who had perfect gnosis of the Savior.
By using the word gnosis, Narcissus has revealed to Irenaeus the core of his heresy. The revelation of gnosis is what replaces the church as a means to salvation. Valentinians therefore valued independence, to the point where anyone with gnosis was given equal rank. Such equity undermined the basis for a conventional hierarchy, which Irenaeus was striving to establish.
Were we all to become Gnostics, where would the church be? There could be no reliable witness before Caesar. One would say one thing and one another, and soon we would become all things to all men and not Christians at all.
The strategy of Irenaeus is the same as Saint Dominic. The church values humility and advocates salvation through obedience to their institution. But to the Valentinians, this was equivalent to spiritual slavery.
We have discovered the truth of our freedom, freedom which the Savior has given us, freedom which we share with him. Why do you wish to enslave us again?
No, Narcissus, I wish only to bring you to humility and obedience to Christ, which is the very mark of a Christian.
Humility? There is light within a man of light, and he lights up the whole world. If he does not shine, he is in darkness.
Where the Valentinians felt oppressed by the church saw them as selfish, since they appeared to be actively working against the establishment of Christianity as a viable candidate for the organized state religion of Rome. And this meant that the memes of Gnosis and liberty could not be allowed to spread.
Narcissus, the simplest man, understands Christ but is baffled by Valentinus. The simple man is edified by love and understands humility. This is the true knowledge of the heart. Were you to continue, the church would collapse and this simple man would be denied the kingdom. Can you understand this, Narcissus? Can you understand this?
I understand. You fear the freedom of the gospel which you preach. How long, I wonder, before it is not your brethren who are persecuted, but my brethren who are persecuted by you.
And you, Narcissus, do you believe in God, or like your namesake, only in yourself?
Bishops like Irenaeus succeeded in driving the Gnostic heresy from the church wherever it was becoming organized, in Rome, Lyon, and the Christian centers within the Roman Empire.
There are many studies of Gnosticism available today, but the one I've chosen is Albert Camus' Christian Metaphysics and Neoplatonism, published when he was only 23 years old. Camus made two unambiguous statements. First, Gnosticism is a Greek reflection upon Christian themes, and second, historically, Gnosticism reveals to Christianity the path not to follow. From our modern perspective, we would applaud the initiative of Gnostics in using philosophy to enhance their faith. On a particular reading of the Bible and the life of Jesus, Gnostics really were the true Christians. But their knowledge, which this documentary defines as knowledge of the heart, was an inner truth belonging to individuals. As a consequence, Gnosis was neither interesting nor useful to people like Irenaeus, who were mainly concerned with the outward survival of a unified Christian religion. In evolutionary terms, the outer truth of the A strategy has been far more successful in spreading its memes through evangelism and institutions. But in order to sustain this fecundity, it must persecute alternatives, especially the inner truth given by Gnosis. Across the four conflicts reviewed in this series, we've learned that the A strategy values humility, ideas, and proofs. It finds salvation through obedience and a Trinitarian delusion of God. The B strategy sees this truth as fundamentally ignorant or shallow, and the insistence on obedience oppressive. B strategists value independence, freedom, and symbols, claiming salvation through the spiritual awakening of Gnosis, which reveals a quaternarian reality of God. In psychological terms, the revelation of Gnosis occurs as the merging of the self with God, which the A strategy believes is responsible for creating selfish, sinful people who delight in pictures and spread nonsense. As a result, the A strategy will reject knowledge claims based on Gnosis as psychotic or self-aggrandizing. There's an old parable from India about a group of blind men and an elephant. The men attempt to describe this animal using only what they can sense with their hands. The moral of the story is that universal truth transcends any one perspective, and that we should not believe that our grasp of truth is privileged over another's. Not only does this story of truth agree with our common sense, it also illustrates the difference between memes and archetypes. As factors of our collective unconscious, archetypes are accessible to everyone in virtue of our shared humanity, but the archetypes themselves cannot be studied as external objects by empirical science. Relative to the unconscious, we are like blind men, consciously unable to confront the entirety of our psyche. By placing our hands on the elephant, we form an opinion, which I would call a meme. An opinion is the seed for a strategy of truth. It's a part of the elephant that might be very important. Even if we don't feel compelled to defend our opinions, they are still potentially something that can be transmitted through persuasion and imitation. What I've elucidated over the course of this series is that the evolution of truth in Western culture is defined by two poles. Our hands have gravitated towards two points on the elephant, which map nicely from the Kepler flood metaphor. The memes of the A strategy are grasping the tail. The memes of the B strategy are grasping the head, or the trunk. The A strategists, who hold the tail firmly, correctly say that the tail is not the elephant. So, when the B strategists claim that they know the entire elephant through the trunk alone, the A strategy will not believe it. Indeed, if the reality of Gnosis was undeniable, then it would overturn the entire parable of the elephant. But without sufficient evidence for this privileged access to the truth, the archetype of conflict will sustain itself through this asymmetry of knowledge. The argument that I've presented in this five-part series has not investigated whether Gnosis is genuine or not. I've only examined the opinions that are produced by Gnostic psychology, or in other words, the memes that Gnostics use to justify their possession of superior knowledge. Thinking only in terms of these memes, the process of cultural evolution is simply the competitive interplay between two strategies for truth. But when we combine these memes with their underlying archetypes, the process becomes the progressive relativization of good and evil. The archetype of conflict can manifest in so many ways because good and evil have sublimated over time, stripping them of their moral casing. It started with the Holy Trinity versus the devil, and has evolved to the point of two logical categories, the correct and the incorrect. In his essay on the Trinity, Jung conceived of a hypothetical turning point for humanity, a time when a cry would be raised for a morality beyond good and evil, no doubt a reference to Nietzsche's book of the same name. For Nietzsche, humanity is defined by a continual process of self-overcoming, and in light of these two strategies, it befits two kinds of overcoming. The task of the A strategy is to overcome fear, as Narcissus remarked in his argument with Irenaeus.
You fear the freedom of the gospel which you preach.
The true source of this fear is not so much the word of the gospel as it is an instinct of species preservation. It is the profound, suspicious fear of an incurable pessimism which compels whole millennia to cling with their teeth to a religious interpretation of existence, the fear born of that instinct which senses that one might get hold of the truth too soon, before mankind was sufficiently strong, sufficiently hard, sufficiently of an artist. In getting a hold of this truth and presenting it to humanity, the B strategy is tasked with overcoming pride. It must learn to acknowledge the ignorance of the A strategy without moralizing the difference, seeing the fear as necessary to sustain our civilization. The knowledge of the B strategy may be superior, but only in terms of inner truth. Nietzsche explained this as follows. The falseness of a judgment is to us not necessarily an objection to a judgment. The question is to what extent it is life-advancing, life-preserving, species-preserving, perhaps even species-breeding. Without granting as true the fictions of logic, without measuring reality against the purely invented world of the unconditional and self-identical, without a continual falsification of the world by means of numbers, mankind could not live. That to renounce false judgments would be to renounce life. There is no expression that is more elegant, in my opinion, of why the A strategy must perpetuate itself. But don't let people like Dawkins fool you. Jung's claim to know God has a perfectly rational basis, if knowledge is defined as gnosis. Furthermore, there is no objective moral law that makes Dawkins' atheism intrinsically wrong. It is simply informed by another opinion of God, fictitious though it may be. His subliminal fear of the alternative is ultimately justified by the unfathomable depths and dangers of the human psyche. This was, after all, Jung's final warning.
One thing is sure, a great change of our psychological attitude is imminent. That is certain.
Why?
Because we need more psychology. We need more understanding of human nature, because the only real danger that exists is man himself. He is the great danger, and we are pitifully unaware of it. We know nothing of man, far too little. His psyche should be studied, because we are the origin of all coming evil.
Spread memes than genes anyway.